For more videos on people's struggles, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Hello and welcome to People's Dispatch. Today we are joined by Dipsita Dhar, who is the All India Joint Secretary of the Students Federation of India, and we're going to talk to her about the call given for a national protest day for May 20th by the All India Forum to Save Public Education. We're going to ask her about this call, why it has been given, and the conditions of students in India today and the struggles being faced by them. So thank you for joining us today. Can you can we first talk about a very pressing issue, which is of online education, which is something schools and institutions of higher education all over the world are moving to online education these days because of this COVID-19 crisis. And while we see that in few places, particularly China, this has been successful, they have been able to do it successfully, but in India, we see that students' groups are opposing this. So why is this opposition here? What are the struggles? What are the challenges in this?
First of all, before going to that debate of digital divide and why we are opposing a digital mode of learning, let me be clear why this Forum for Saving Public Education came up. It came up during the time when the new education policy was announced. And once all of us got to know about the nuances of the new education policy, we understood that this is something which is going to completely devastate the public education system which is there in place. We have already seen that after the 90s, there was a rampant decentralization. We are seeing all the, the government schools have been shut. We are seeing the non-government players are investing more and more and getting a lot of space in the education sphere, to be particular. But this new education policy actually furthered the case. They are saying it on our face that the government is no more going to pay for your education. So they are talking about financial autonomy. So all the government colleges, schools, universities, which were the only places left where people from the poorer section, people from the marginalized section could get good education in very small amount of money. Now you are saying even those universities, those institutions also are going to get their own finances. And how they are going to do it? They are saying that you have to, I mean, the only way left is that you have to increase the fee. You have to increase the semester fee, you have to increase the hostel fee, and have to get the money from the student itself. They're also saying that earlier how we have university grant commission used to give grant to the institution. Now this concept of grant is no more there. Now the government is going to give you loan. Now once you give loan, that loan needs to be paid back also. Now, how an education institution, which is not a factory, which is not a corporate organization, which does not really create any surplus or any profit in that way, how they're going to pay back the money? Again, the load, the burden is going to come just on the shoulder of the students. So we thought this is something which are going to stop the way of education for a lot of people in our country. And that was the time when different left organizations, along with that, all the other people, all the other student organizations, who thought that on this particular topic, on this particular policies, they can come with us. We all came together and found this forum. Now today, we again have come together and given this call tomorrow because we are seeing that during the pandemic, there were multiple problems of students. Of course, there is a problem that the school, college, universities are shut. So all our academic calendar is a little disrupted. All the syllabus that needs to be completed, that was not done. But along with that, we also have seen that the students who are coming from the poorer section, the children of the workers' family, the children of the poorer family, the children from the marginalized section, they are itself having a crisis, which is not only about whether their syllabus is going to get completed or not, but whether they're going to stay alive once the lockdown is over or not, whether there is going to be enough food in their home or not. So when the large section of our student community is suffering at this kind of, fighting at this kind of battle, our government comes and tell that, okay, there's a solution of everything. Everything is going to go in digital now. Now, the government has completely forgotten that what is the internet penetration rate in our country. Except Kerala and Delhi, there are hardly states which have a 50% or in and around percentage of internet penetration. So what will happen to the other states? Along with that, we also know that, having a phone itself is a privilege. Having a smartphone, having an Android phone or having an uninterrupted internet, 4G, 5G speed, 3G speed, or electricity. These are not something which is accessible to everyone. when a student come to school, come to college or university, when that person is sitting inside her his or her classroom, at least this are the not problem what she or he is facing. Now you are saying on the primarity of access, who is going to get education, who is going to get the lecture, who is going to be able to write examination and the assignment itself is dependent on whether you have internet or not, whether you have a smartphone or not, whether you have a personal laptop or access to a computer or not. So in a time when already the people of our country are suffering, are fighting their battle of survival, now you are saying that children of those families, that if you do not have phone, if you don't have internet, you don't have to study. It is not at all important that, you know, you have to study if you don't have all these privileges and access to all these things. And one thing what we also want to reiterate that all this, you know, paranoia about we have to complete our syllabus, we have to do the examination and all these things. So are these syllabuses or the books that you have said that needs to be completed in this stipulated time, are there something which is can't be changed? Because this is not something which is a very particular thing on India. No? All across the country, all across the globe, we are seeing that people are facing a similar kind of, you know, situation. So even if the government together thinks of changing the module or, you know, do some relaxation in the syllabus, it is not going to be a big deal. But what is going to be a big deal is if in a distressed situation like that, you come and tell a children from a poor family that if you don't have phone, if you don't have internet, do not study. The desire, the aspiration of what the people from marginalized communities, the poorer families, what they have got. They might be the first generation learner. They might be the first person from their community or their village to go to a university. If we are saying that if you are so interested in, you know, doing a digital mode or a digital learning, first you create the digital infrastructure. You are, you know, taking the example of China. In China, they could do it because they already have that infrastructure in place. But in a country like India, where the government didn't make the digital infrastructure so far, even after so many years, you really cannot expect. If you say some, you know, suddenly out of nowhere that everything is going to be online now, it is discriminated. It's exclusionary. You are saying only people with privilege can study, others cannot. And that's the primary reason why you are opposing the, you know, the digital learning or all the online examination that have been proposed.
And you talked about the students' survival, that how so many in the community are, so many in the student community are fighting for survival right now. Then all of this pressure and all of this shift to the online mode is happening. And in this time, we also, in context of this fight for survival, what is the condition of scholarships and fellowships? Because of course, that is also very important right now, especially in the when we see the situation of the extreme job losses and the agrarian distress. So how is that? Are those scholarships still being regularly disbursed?
No. I mean, scholarships were never been regularly disbursed. But during this time also, we at least expected that thinking the crisis that the country is going through, our government will be a little more sensitive. And at least this time, they will make sure that people who are stuck at hostels, people who are stuck at away from their home has some money in their hand. But we have seen that for last 4 months, particularly if you look at my university, JNU, the non-net fellowship that we used to get, for last 4 months, the money has not come. So what happens once you are in a hostel, you really don't have to, I mean, we don't have to pay our mess bill every month. That kind of system is still there. So you can, you know, pay it back, I mean, pay all the money once just end of the semester with some amount of late fee. But what about the people who are staying in rent? What about the people who are stuck at different places? What about the people who are in home for whom their scholarship or fellowship was one important source of income? Now, once you just spoke about there is a huge job loss, a lot of people have become newly unemployed. There's no money, there is no income that is coming in their home. And then all that scholarship and that fellowship that could at least give some sort of sustenance to this family or to this individual who are stuck at different places, that has also not been disbursed regularly. So this is also one of our demands, that all the scholarships, all the fellowship that need to be regularized. And this is a long-standing demand because we have seen earlier also, let it be JRF, SRF or the non-net, they will come in bulk. But the thing is that how you're going to survive before that? I mean, if you're someone in your MPhil first year and if you're getting all your money in the last of the semester, what about the, you know, the previous 5 months? How you're going to take care of your expenses? If you have some other income source, of your parents or your family still support you, that's a different case. But we know in our university, the so-called one of the best universities in India, there also there are so many students who do not, first, they do not take any money from their home. Secondly, that little amount of money they get as a form of fellowship or scholarship, from there also they send it back to their home, with which maybe their sisters go to college, their sisters go to school. So in a situation like that, the fact that the government has not been sensible enough to disburse the scholarship or fellowship is also something that is very concerning. So this is also one of our important demands. Whatever money, which is our due money, which we get because of our merit, please disburse it and make sure that everybody gets it.
And can you also talk more in detail about the situation of students' accommodations, both in hostels and right. also, of course, in rented accommodations? How are they coping with this?
So the people, I would say the people who are at least in hostels, things are a little better. Because, for instance, hostels like JNU, you're at least getting the food and everything. Though there is a change in the menu and all. But still, three times whatever you used to get earlier before the lockdown, the similar kind of food pattern is maintained. So the people who are right now in a hostel, they're still in a better condition in a gated campus like JNU. But I'm not sure if that's the same case in the other hostels, because there were some distressed call from some people from AMU, Aligarh Muslim University. Some 700 students from West Bengal are stuck there. And the 700 students, many of them are hostel residents, and a lot of them actually took rooms outside in rent. So for them, getting food every day, buying food, cooking it, having money to spend, all these things are becoming a really, really big issue. For many, maybe not rent is the primary thing, but having money to cook food, having money to buy food, and having money to sustain themselves is becoming a big problem. Along with that, of course, there's a problem of rent. As we know, in Delhi, we have a union, a student-tenant union, where we are trying to, the people who are staying in rent, trying to, bring them in a single platform, and trying to figure out a way. Because there are also a lot of, there are different dimensions, particularly in case of Delhi. Many small renters, like the people who give their homes in a minimum money, many times the house owner, him or herself, is dependent on that money that you pay as rent. A lot of elderly whose, children do not stay with them, they stay outside or abroad. So that's the only income source for them. So it's a very difficult condition. That's why you have demanded to the all the government that you have written. First of all, you take them back. You take us back. All of us want to go home. People who are in rented accommodation, there's a scarcity of food. There's a scarcity of security. We want to go back home. So you make sure that that is done, because the government has done it already. We have seen so many students who were studying at Kota in the coaching institution. Hmm. They were all taken back. Things happened in West Bengal. Things happened in Uttar Pradesh. So if these students could be taken back to their homes, why can't we be? And this is also one of our demands that you're going to raise tomorrow, that in all the rented accommodation, the people who are stuck, one, they should be taken back. Secondly, the places where there's a situation of rent agreement, the government should intervene and should make sure that nobody is, that it's not like that somebody is being harmed or somebody is not in a beneficiary position. But the government needs to intervene and make sure that both the parties are in an equal position.
Hmm. And if we talk about the issue of student activism, of course, we see in India under this right-wing government, even during this pandemic, it's like they're taking advantage of this pandemic because people are not able to resist in ways they normally resist. So still this crackdown on activists is happening. Can you talk particularly about student activists and the situation they're facing?
I mean, it was very unfortunate when every day we got to know that someone or some of our comrades or some people who were along with us in the movement are being targeted, someone's phone is being taken, someone is arrested. And if you're going to look into the pattern, you will see the people who were arrested so far are, first, they were majorly the students of Jamia Millia Islamia, and also majority of them are Muslims. I mean, when we talk about the witch hunting of activists, let us not ignore the fact that their identity as a Muslim played a huge role. Because if you look, why they were arrested, they were told that they were involved into the Delhi riots. All the people who have been targeted, arrested, all the charges that are put, they're all in and around the violence, the riot that has happened in Delhi. Now, the thing is, we know that the students didn't have really any role to play there. These were the people who run they started their campaign, they started their movement once the police attacked in Jamia. once their comrades, their friends, the students were beaten up inside their hostels, inside their library. After that, out of outrage, people came down to streets. Hmm. And Jamia Millia Islamia was leading the struggle. Hmm. In Shaheen Bagh, when Shaheen Bagh happened, there also these were the students who were leading it. And now how these two completely unrelated things, the incident of Jamia Millia, the protest that was happening there, and how the communal clash happened in Delhi and the other parts, how they were linked. And it seemed like they were trying to show it like that these are the people who are speaking against CAA, who are speaking against NRC, who are speaking against the minority witch hunting, who are speaking for the right of the students to speak. These are the people who have done all the wrong things. So we have seen that not for a single time they really spoken about Kapil Mishra, the BJP MLA, who have come and told, it's communally charged words. They have told in front of the police that if you do not take the protest out, we are going to take the law and order in our hands and you're going to take care of it. So many people, so many student activists, so many Muslim student activists have been arrested, have been targeted, but not a single word about all these BJP leaders who were present, and the video went viral. Everybody has seen that how he actually, made sure that in Delhi there's a riot happening. So this is something which I think is something that we all should be really scared of, because we have seen during the NRCCA protest also, students came down to streets in a large number. Students became the voice. Students were the first to come down to streets and make it a point that we are not going to let this country to be turned into a Hindi, Hindu, Hindustan. This country is of everyone. And we have seen this vibrant protest all across the country, led by the young people, led by the Muslim woman. And it was unstoppable. I mean, even after doing so many things, BJP could not really stop it. Nowhere the Shaheen Bagh that were erupted across the country were closed down, because people came down spontaneously. The energy of the youth, the energy of the student gave them this motivation to continue their struggle. So now what they're doing, they're saying that that time they could not crush it. They could not crush it democratically. Their propaganda failed. But now when our previous mode of protest, our traditional mode of protest are no more workable, they're just using this time. Target the people to make sure that nobody speak against this government. And this is a threat. This is an open threat to the minority of this country who are vocal about their right, who are political in their nature, that if you're going to speak against the government, you're going to be put behind the bars. And that's why we have taken this demand as another important demand for tomorrow's protest, that campus democracy, the right of people to speak what they think, the right of students to do politics, to engage in political conversation, that cannot be curbed. A lot of people are trying to say that, this is not the time you should do politics. This is the time you should only talk about COVID. You only should talk about stay home and all that kind of thing, about physical distancing. On the name of lockdown, in the name of pandemic, you cannot take away the hard-earned democratic rights from us. And that's why this is also one of our major demands that we're going to put tomorrow.
And you talked about the national education policy right in the beginning, and how that is an issue which was very actively resisted by students earlier when it first came out. And we, of course, now in this time of physical distancing, we see that kind of resistance is getting increasingly difficult. And that's why perhaps this Indian government is pushing through moves which, it wouldn't have been able to earlier as easily, especially the extensive privatization. So how are student organizations now planning to carry out resistance in the future? Tomorrow and in the future and other movements, and also what are some of the demands, major demands that you might not have mentioned earlier?
One thing is, as you said, that all our traditional way of protesting is no more. We cannot do it in the similar way. So the last protest that we did, we also did another protest a few days back, which named Bhashan Nahi Rashan. So we came down to our balcony in front of our door and we hold the placard saying that Bhashan Nahi Rashan Chahiye. Because we were seeing that when the death of migrant workers were happening, and let it be on Narendra Modi or our finance minister, except their their oratory, except their flowery words, they are not really giving anything. So we made it a point that to make sure to let the people know through social media with all the demands written in our placard to put our voice across, to make sure that the voice of the migrant laborers, the voice of the poor people, marginalized people who are struggling to survive, their voice is hurt somehow. So today, tomorrow also, our plan is that similar. We are going to do primarily a social media campaign. We are going to stand in front of our door, in our balcony, or just outside. We're going to click pictures of it. We are going to put content in social media. We are also thinking of a Twitter storm around 11 o'clock so that the topic, that the plight of the students, the problem that as students we are facing, that also somewhere get noticed. Because nowhere so far in the package or even in the bhashan of our prime minister or finance minister, they really didn't mention about student. It seemed that we are invisible. Nothing was told that how we are going to come back, about our scholarship, about our fellowship. So the thing that we are apprehending, the thing that we are fearing is that a lot of people are going to be dropped out because our income source are going to be limited. So in the poorer families, to support their family, a lot of students who are earlier used to maybe going to school, college or university, they will stop pursuing their career and they will try to get some other job or something to support their family because their income source is being quenched. So in a situation like that, we are thinking that if the government is not really strategizing, if the government is really not thinking how to get these people back or how to stop them from being dropping out, then it's going to be a very difficult situation. Because in India, we have to do so many things to make sure that our literacy is going up. We have done so many efforts, so many policies were there to make sure that the people are there in the education arena. Now, with the lockdown, with the loss of employment, a lot of people who were earlier in the education sphere, they're going to be dropped out. The women in particular, because in our society, in a patriarchal society, the women's education is the least priority. So this is also something what you want to raise with our protest tomorrow, that the government should have a strategy. What you're going to do with these people? What the government can do to stop a large section of people going out of the education arena? Because these are the people who came from a very struggling background, a marginalized society. Now, when you think of a progress of a society, the progress of the society is dependent on how many people you are joining in. If these people who are historically deprived, these people who are historically discriminated, if they're again lost out of our this process of mobility, then how the society, how the country is going to get its progress? So this is also something that we want our government to think of, because we understand that this government is not something which are going to think of people. It's not something we are going to think of the poorer people. But that does not mean that we are going to stop from our end. We are limited in power. Our sources are limited. But that is not going to something that's going to stop us. With all our resources, we are going to at least make sure that the demands that we are raising, that the concern that we are raising, that should reach to the government. And if somehow, if some miracle happens, and if they really, think of us, and if they really act upon it, that will be good for everyone, for the country.
Thank you. Thank you for talking to us. And this is all the time we have. Thank you for watching People's Dispatch.